Since my last video, in which I suggested that it's a good idea for Zoroastrian to adopt the Christian or the Muslim tradition of giving 10% of their income, at least, to the Zoroastrian association of their locality to be used for common good. Since that video, I have received some feedback from some of the concerned Zoroastrians. A few of them were in connection with the general idea of those are the Abrahamic religion traditions, and we have our own thing, the Zoroastrians, we have our own thing, and we like to keep it that way. And it's working fine, it's okay, it's working okay. Well, regarding this point of view, my answer is that no, actually it's not working fine. It's not working fine. Who told you? Because if you're well off and you're doing well in your family, most of your family is doing well, that doesn't mean that the Zoroastrian community is doing fine. Here's the thing. Can anybody name a good Zoroastrian hospital in any of the major cities that Zoroastrians reside in? Tehran, Bombay, Los Angeles. Do we have any Zoroastrian hospitals that top rated? I'm not talking about some shitty clinic, some corner of some parking lot calling itself a Zoroastrian clinic. No, no, no. I'm talking about a good hospital. Here's the thing, folks. By setting our standards low, that doesn't mean we are doing fine. We are doing okay. We seem to be doing okay because our standards are low. We have to bring up the standards. How do you bring up the standards is when money is available to the Zoroastrian associations, to the board of trustees of Zoroastrian associations, to the managers of Zoroastrian associations all over the world. When the money is available, then the standards can be brought up higher. Here's the thing. Now I'm bringing up the Jews a lot because they are a model that we can copy. Why? Because their numbers are not that high. They're like 5-6 million Jews all over the world. Yes, they're about 200,000-300,000 Zoroastrians all over the world as well. But how one way we can cure that is through conversion. Start converting people. Whoever wants to be a Zoroastrian, convert them. Better yet, when you tell them that you have to give 10% of your income every month to the Zoroastrian Association, that's one way of making sure you're converting the right people. People whose heart is in the right place. And you can even tell them that for 1 year before your conversion, you have to give your 10% of your income to the Zoroastrian Association for 1 year, and then we convert you, and then you have to continue with that 10%, giving that 10% to the Zoroastrian Association. That's where you can actually separate the men from the boys. You can separate those who truly want to become Zoroastrian and those who want some kind of gain from being a Zoroastrian. You can separate them by just telling them you have to pay to be 10%, period. Anyway, I bring up the Jews is because their numbers are small, and because but their spread and their how they're conducting their tribe, their group, is what we should be copying. Here's how it is working out for the Jews. In every major capital city of every state of America, there is one, at least one, Jewish hospital which is rated amongst the top five of that state. It doesn't have anybody's name on it, like Rostam or Jamshid or Sohrab or... No. It's known as Bethlehem or this or Bethlehem that. It's literally right in the name. It's the name of a Jewish city or a Jewish symbol, or you can tell it's a Jewish hospital. It's usually 99% of the time is the biggest and the best equipped and top of the line hospital of its city, of its state, in almost every state of United States. In European capitals, you can find usually one of the top five hospitals is Jewish owned, Jewish run. Do Zoroastrians have a single hospital anywhere which is known as a Zoroastrian hospital, which gives services to Zoroastrians as well as non-Zoroastrians? No, not that I heard of. Here's the thing, folks. These Jewish hospitals, not only they can provide good services to the Jews and maybe provide free services to the Jews who are less well off, but they are a way for the Jews to create goodwill amongst the non-Jews. There are many, 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 many patients in these Jewish hospitals who are not Jews and who are paying good money to receive top-of-the-line healthcare. Why not? How these hospitals are built? With Jewish money. How? 10% of your income. Move away from hospitals. Some of the best clinics that deal with alcohol dependency are Jewish owned, Jewish run. They're in the United States. Some of the best clinics, you can call them clinics, you can call them hotels, they're basically hideaways. You can call them hospices. They're hideaways that people go and basically admit themselves in, and they stay anywhere from a week, 2 weeks, to a month, 2 months, 3 months. Some of the best of these places are Jewish owned and Jewish run. I personally know, and I don't know that many Zoroastrians, but I personally know at least 10 Zoroastrians who have alcohol dependency issues. Do we have an equivalent within the Zoroastrian community that they can go and admit themselves into that institution and get help? No. I at least know at least 5 Zoroastrians who are suffering from drug dependency. Do we have any kind of institution? Do Zoroastrians have any kind of institution that deals with this matter? Folks, by not admitting that we have issues like all other people, like all other societies, by not admitting that like all other societies, we Zoroastrians have alcoholics, have drug addicts, have battered spouses issues. We don't even have a place, an institution, an organization, an office with maybe a psychologist or a psychiatrist available on hand that can guide people through issues that they have in their life. We have a lot of battered spouses. Spouses who are getting battered by their other half. And we don't have any place that these people can go to seek help, to seek justice, to seek resolution, to seek psychological help. Folks, we are a shell of a tribe. We are a shell of a tribe. We have no, absolutely no institutions or organizations to take care of any of our social needs. And then you have a few Zoroastrians who have contacted me and they're like, no, we're fine, we're doing well. We are good as we are. We don't need to collect money, to pull our money together, to build anything new, to do anything. We're just fine as we are. Folks, those of you who think we are fine as we are, you're living in an illusion. Maybe you're doing well, your family is doing well, maybe you don't know any drug addicts, or you pretend not to know any Zoroastrians with drug dependency, with opium dependency, with heroin dependency, or you pretend not to know any Zoroastrians with alcohol dependency, you pretend not to know any Zoroastrians who are being battered by their spouses, you pretend, or you think if you don't talk about it, it will go away. Or it doesn't exist because we are Zoroastrians. We have good words, good deeds, good thoughts. That's it. We are the best. Oh, fuck you. Fuck you and your illusion. No. Like every other society, we have these issues. But unlike most tribes, most societies, most group, most associations, we try to stay away from them. We keep talking about how our good parts, our good people, how a few of the good ones, and then we ignore the troubled ones. Folks, society is not just made of successful ones and the good ones. It also has its issues with the bad ones and unsuccessful ones and troubled ones. If a society turns its back on the troubled ones, if the good ones, those who are doing all right, turn their back on the troubled ones, what happens is just the numbers decreases. Why? Because the troubled ones are troubled for a period in their life. If they're helped out, they're pulled out of their trouble with the amenities that we can provide, with the help that the society, that the Zoroastrian society can provide, they eventually will climb out of the hole that they were in for whatever reason they were in that hole. And become all right, will do all right in their life. With the added fact that now they are very grateful to the Zoroastrian Association who helped them to get out of that hellhole that they were in, and now you have a very good Zoroastrian who will stay true to his faith, to his tribe, to his group, to his association until the end. I don't have to go through all this, explain all of this. Any one of you can think and come to the same conclusion. You keep the people around you, even the troubled ones, because eventually those troubled ones, if taken care of, will become okay. Will start doing well in their life. But now, because you have helped them, you have bought their loyalty and the loyalty of their family and the loyalty of their kids, and they will stay true to you until the end. And that's what it is. That's what the society is. Not only trumpeting their success, but also taking care of their fallen until they can get on their feet. That's where the hospital comes from. That's where why we need a Zoroastrian hospital, we need a Zoroastrian hospice, we need a Zoroastrian clinic dealing with drug dependency, we need a Zoroastrian clinic dealing with alcohol dependency, we need more Zoroastrian schools. Hey, build them, build the Zoroastrian school. Let the motherfuckers know this is a Zoroastrian school. So what? You have maybe 50%, maybe 20% Zoroastrian students. The other 80% are non-Zoroastrian. Let them come in. Every time that they come in to that school, they read the note, the name of the school above the door. They read Zoroastrian school. That creates goodwill. You're providing a good service to the even the non-Zoroastrians around you. You charge them for it, but it's a good service. They're willing payers. But you have to build. You have to be the one to build it. And here's the second thought. We as a Zoroastrian people, as a Zoroastrian community, cannot depend on the rich guy that once in a while comes and throws a whole lot of money by himself or herself into an issue and builds something and then drops dead. The reason for that is simple. These individuals who have two qualities, they have big wallets and they have big hearts. For somebody to come in and build something on his own and donate it to the Zoroastrian community and then go away, it needs a big wallet and it needs a big heart. These individuals do come along, but they come but one in a generation. One or two in a generation. There is not that many of them. Some have large wallets, but they don't have a large heart. Some have a large heart, but they don't have a large wallet. So this does not work out. Depending on individuals to come in and do something good for the community, it's a fool's errand. You can't depend on that. You're wasting your life if you're thinking that we have to wait until one person, we find one person who has a large heart and a large wallet and comes and does something good for us. That doesn't work. There's only 100,000 of us. Let's say 300,000 of us, and one in every generation, let's say one in every 100,000, that would be like three in every generation. Doesn't work out. The better way to go about this is the 10%. We each pay 10% of our income per month, per year, to the Zoroastrian Association of our locality, and this money can pull together and build something from a hospital to a hospice to a clinic to a school to those free services that I mentioned in my previous videos, free wedding services for everybody, free birthday services, free circumcision services, parties for everybody. To do all of this, we have to all chip in. And the 10% will take care of this. But what we cannot do is depend on wait until one individual comes and builds something. That's just, you're wasting your time. We are wasting our time. It's much better to collect a little from everybody than collect a lot from one person. On a lighter note, somebody made a comment regarding circumcision parties and what is that, and we don't have a tradition of that, and that's a joke, right? Well, no, it's not a joke. And yes, it's not a Zoroastrian tradition, anything by the name of circumcision party. It's a Jewish tradition. But the point was not why is there a party. The point was a free party, free, paid for by the Zoroastrian Association, because the point is bringing people together to associate, to network. Why these people are getting together, who the fuck cares? It's a wedding. It's a birthday. It's a circumcision. It's a fire in the middle of a field.
Me. Come here. Come here.
It's a fire in the middle of a field.
Me.
It's people throwing water on each other. Who the fuck cares what reason? What is the reason? Who the hell cares what's the reason for people gathering? The point is the gathering part. The point is coming together to associate, to network. And when the association has enough funds to make this gathering free for a minimum number of people, as many as possible, that's how you grow the network. That's how you better the network. It wasn't a question of, oh, we have this tradition or we don't have that tradition. It's you adapt whatever you need to adapt so you can survive, so you can live better. Is circumcision parties that much more sillier than Sadeh or Abrizan or Mehregan or Tirgan? Are you fucking kidding me? They're all silly games, silly get-togethers. The reason might be silly, but the point is the getting together part, the networking part. That is not funny, that's serious matter. You unite, you get together, you unite, you network, you form a stronger union. You form a stronger tribe. Then you pull your money together with the 10% donation of your income to the association to make even a stronger tribe, to make even a stronger association, to build the hospitals, to build the clinics, and to build whatever you need to build to promote yourself, advertise yourself, to bring goodwill from outside, non-Zoroastrians, and to better the lives of the tribe of Zoroastrians. And on top of all this, the idea is the collecting 10% for the betterment of Zoroastrian people. Collecting 10% by the Zoroastrian Association. That's the main idea. What this money is used for, who am I to tell anybody what to use this money for? My message was to collect this money. Then you hire a board of trustees, let's say a 12-member board of trustees. Then you hire a couple of good managers, a couple of visionary managers, and they decide what's the best use for this money. In what way more number of Zoroastrians can benefit by spending this money? What is better? What is needed? Who am I to say what should that money be spent upon? That was just an idea. Hey, this money can be used to throw free wedding parties for Zoroastrians with at least 500 invitees. In my idea, that's one way to increase the number of meetings, increase the networking aspect of people of the tribe. That was just a suggestion. You can do that, you don't have to do that, but it's a good idea. Or the birthday parties. Any kind of party for any reason. Or sade, what do you think sade is? Just coming together, people coming together and lighting a fire. That's it. It's free because they don't serve you any food or drinks. But you have to serve food and drinks in a wedding, in a birthday party or a circumcision party. You have to serve something. So that's because you have to serve something, then becomes a question of money. How much money do you want to spend? And because not everybody is well off, people start cutting people off, saying, okay, I don't want to have more than 100 guests, more than 200 guests, more than 300 guests. And that was my suggestion, that this is not a good idea. People start cutting people off and inviting less and less and less number of guests is just decreasing the chances of Zoroastrian meeting each other and finding networking and finding business partners and finding marriage partners and finding, and in general, networking. And the idea was that if the association starts, Zoroastrian association starts paying for these parties, these wedding parties, then the Zoroastrian association can give a free hand to the bride and groom and tell them, you can invite 500 guests free of charge. Start inviting people. Just so people can meet, network, form a stronger tribe. Again, just a suggestion. But the point of the piece was the 10% of every Zoroastrian's income has to be collected. That's the main aspect. Now, once this money accumulates, where is it best to spend this money on? What is it best to spend this money on? Maybe in Kerman, they want to spend it on rehabilitation program for drug dependencies. Maybe in Yazd, they want to spend it on something else. Maybe in Los Angeles, they want to spend it on something else. That is for the Zoroastrian Association of that particular locality to take a good look at and find what is the best use for this money in our association. What the Zoroastrians of our locality need the most. Maybe in Los Angeles, the most important thing Zoroastrians need is a hospital right now, because the health insurance is so expensive in the United States. Maybe a hospital, a Zoroastrian hospital that can take care of everybody, but non-Zoroastrians have to pay good money to receive top-notch healthcare in that hospital, but Zoroastrians can pay less or free or whatever. But the point is collection of money. Once you collect it, then this association, the board of trustees of that particular association, can determine what they want to do with that money. But the money has to be collected. On a side note, I know this for fact in United States. It might be true also in Canada. The rest of the world, I don't know. But I know for fact that in United States, whatever you, any person pays into any non-profit organization, which religious organization such as Zoroastrian Association is considered one, is a, considered a non-profit association, whatever individuals give to non-profit associations, at the end of the year they can take it off their taxes. Let me put it in a simpler terms. By law, if you have paid $10,000 in taxes last year, this year you can pay $9,000, if you pay $9,000 to the Zoroastrian Association of, let's say, Los Angeles, at the end of the year, you only pay $1,000 to United States government in taxes. I repeat again, if you paid $10,000 in taxes to the United States government last year, and this year you assume you're going to pay the same $10,000, before you file your taxes, if you pay $9,000 to the Zoroastrian Association of your choice, and you have proof of it, that you have paid this much to the Zoroastrian Association, which is a non-profit organization, you can show that proof to the United States government as part of your tax filing, and tell United States government, I have already paid $9,000 to this non-profit association, Zoroastrian Association, so you only pay $1,000 to United States government. In other words, instead of paying your taxes to United States government, you can pay all of your taxes to the non-profit organization of your choice, and that's legal. And the Jews and the Mormons are taking full advantage of this. Instead of paying their taxes to United States government, they are paying their taxes as donations to their church, their temple, their synagogue. Specifically, Zoroastrians living in the United States, this is a no-brainer. You have to do this. Instead of paying United States government, just collect all, give all the taxes that you have to pay, give it to Zoroastrian Association of your localities. Canada, Australia, and the rest of the world, just do a little digging and find out if you can do the same. Even if you can't do the same, consider the 10% as extra tax you're paying to your own tribe for your own benefit, for the benefit of your children and your grandchildren and the future generations. If you're having a community, if you're having a tribe, let's start running this tribe in a logical manner. It's just as simple as that. Let's start running this shit like we're logical human beings, like we're intelligent human beings.